This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information on how to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recorded by Lena Taylor of the I Read Comics podcast. A Journey to the Interior of the Earth by Jules Verne. Chapter 36. Calm Philosophic Discussions. Here I end what I may call my log, happily saved from the wreck, and I resume my narrative as before. What happened when the raft was dashed upon the rocks is more than I can tell. I felt myself hurled into the waves, and if I escaped from death, and if my body was not torn over the sharp edges of the rocks, it was because the powerful arm of Hans came to my rescue. The brave Icelander carried me out of the reach of the waves, over a burning sand, where I found myself by the side of my uncle. Then he returned to the rocks, against which the furious waves were beating, to save what he could. I was unable to speak. I was shattered with fatigue and excitement. I wanted a whole hour to recover even a little. But a deluge of rain was still falling, though with that violence which generally denotes the near cessation of a storm. A few overhanging rocks afforded us some shelter from the storm. Hans prepared some food, which I could not touch, and each of us, exhausted with 3 sleepless nights, fell into a broken and painful sleep. The next day the weather was splendid. The sky and the sea had sunk into sudden repose. Every trace of the awful storm had disappeared. The exhilarating voice of the professor fell upon my ears as I awoke. He was ominously cheerful. "Well, my boy," he cried, "have you slept well?" Would not anyone have thought that we were still in our cheerful little house on the Königstrasse, and that I was only just coming down to breakfast, and that I was to be married to Gräuben that day? Alas! If the tempest had but sent the raft a little more east, we should have passed under Germany, under my beloved town of Hamburg, under the very street where dwelt all that I loved most in the world. Then only 40 leagues would have separated us. But they were 40 leagues perpendicular of solid granite wall, and in reality we were 1,000 leagues asunder. All these painful reflections rapidly crossed my mind before I could answer my uncle's question. "Well, now," he repeated, "won't you tell me how you have slept?" "Oh, very well," I said. "I am only a little knocked up, but I shall soon be better." "Oh," said my uncle, "that's nothing to signify. You are only a little bit tired." "But you, uncle, you seem in very good spirits this morning." "Delighted, my boy, delighted. We have got there." "To our journey's end?" "No, but we have got to the end of that endless sea. Now we shall go by land and really begin to go down, down, down." "But, my dear uncle, do let me ask you one question." "Of course, Axel." "How about returning?" "Returning? Why, you are talking about the return before the arrival." "No, I only want to know how that is to be managed." "In the simplest way possible. When we have reached the center of the globe, either we shall find some new way to get back, or we shall come back like decent folks the way we came. I feel pleased at the thought that it is sure not to be shut against us." "But then we shall have to refit the raft."
"Of course."
"Then, as to provisions, have we enough to last?"
"Yes, to be sure we have. Hans is a clever fellow, and I am sure he must have saved a large part of our cargo. But still, let us go and make sure." We left this grotto which lay open to every wind. At the same time I cherished a trembling hope which was a fear as well. It seemed to me impossible that the terrible wreck of the raft should not have destroyed everything on board. On my arrival on the shore, I found Hans surrounded by an assemblage of articles all arranged in good order. My uncle shook hands with him with a lively gratitude. This man, with almost superhuman devotion, had been at work while all the while that we were asleep, and had saved the most precious of the articles at the risk of his life. Not that we had suffered no losses, for instance, our firearms, but we might do without them. Our stock of powder had remained uninjured after having risked blowing up during the storm. "Well," cried the professor, "as we have no guns, we cannot hunt, that's all." "Yes, but how about the instruments?" "Here is the aneroid, the most useful of all, and for which I would have given all the others. By means of it I can calculate the depth and know when we have reached the center. Without it we might very likely go beyond and come out at the Antipodes." Such high spirits as these were rather too strong. "But where is the compass?" I asked. "Here it is, upon this rock, in perfect condition, as well as the thermometers and the chronometer. The hunter is a splendid fellow." There was no denying it. We had all our instruments. As for tools and appliances, there they all lay on the ground, ladders, ropes, picks, spades, etc. Still, there was the question of provisions to be settled, and I asked, "How are we off for provisions?" The boxes containing these were in a line upon the shore, in a perfect state of preservation. For the most part the sea had spared them, and what with biscuits, salt meat, spirits, and salt fish, we might reckon on 4 months' supply. 4 months!" cried the professor. "We have time to go and to return, and with all that is left I will give a grand dinner to my friends at the Johannium." I ought by this time to have been quite accustomed to my uncle's ways, yet there was always something fresh about him to astonish me. "Now," said he, "we will replenish our supply of water with the rain which the storm has left us in all these granite basins. Therefore we shall have no reason to fear anything from thirst. As for the raft, I will recommend Hans to do his best to repair it, although I don't expect it will be of any further use to us." "How so?" I cried. "An idea of my own, my lad. I don't think we shall come out by the way that we went in." I stared at the professor with a good deal of mistrust. I asked, was he not touched in the brain? And yet there was method in his madness. "And now let us go to breakfast," said he. I followed him to a headland, after he had given his instructions to the hunter. There preserved meat, biscuits, and tea made us an excellent meal, one of the best I ever remember. Hunger, the fresh air, the calm, quiet weather, after the commotions we had gone through, all contributed to give me a good appetite. Whilst breakfasting, I took the opportunity to put to my uncle the question where we were now. "That seems to me," I said, "rather difficult to make out." "Yes, it is difficult," he said, "to calculate exactly. Perhaps even impossible, since during these 3 stormy days I have been unable to keep any account of the rate or direction of the raft. But still, we may get an approximation." "The last observation," I remarked, "was made on the island where the geyser was." "You mean Axel Island. Don't decline the honor of having given your name to the first island ever discovered in the central parts of the globe." "Well," said I, "let it be Axel Island." Then we had cleared 270 leagues of sea, and we were 600 leagues from Iceland. "Very well," answered my uncle. "Let us start from that point and count 4 days' storm, during which our rate cannot have been less than 80 leagues in the 24 hours." "That is right, and this would make 300 leagues more." "Yes, and the Liedenbrock Sea would be 600 leagues from shore to shore. Surely, Axel, it may vie in size with the Mediterranean itself." "Especially," I replied, "if it happens that we have only crossed it in its narrowest part. And it is a curious circumstance," I added, "that if my computations are right, and we are 900 leagues from Reykjavik, we now have the Mediterranean above our head." "That is a good long way, my friend. But whether we are under Turkey or the Atlantic depends very much on the question in which direction we have been moving. Perhaps we have deviated." "No, I think not. Our course has been the same all along, and I believe this shore is southeast of Port Grauben." "Well," replied my uncle, "we may easily ascertain this by consulting the compass. Let us go and see what it says." The professor moved toward the rock upon which Hans had laid down the instruments. He was gay and full of spirits. He rubbed his hands. He studied his attitudes. I followed him, curious to know if I was right in my estimate. As soon as we had arrived at the rock, my uncle took the compass, laid it horizontally, and questioned the needle, which, after a few oscillations, presently assumed a fixed position. My uncle looked, and looked, and looked again. He rubbed his eyes, and then turned to me, thunderstruck with some unexpected discovery. "What is the matter?" I asked. He motioned me to look. An exclamation of astonishment burst from me. The north pole of the needle was turned to what we supposed to be the south. It pointed to the shore instead of to the open sea. I shook the box, examined it again. It was in perfect condition. In whatever position I placed the box, the needle pertinaciously returned to this unexpected quarter. Therefore, there seemed no reason to doubt that during the storm there had been a sudden change of wind unperceived by us, which had brought our raft back to the shore, which we thought we had left so long a distance behind us. End of chapter 36. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information on how to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recorded by Lana Taylor of the I Read Comics podcast. A Journey to the Interior of the Earth by Jules Verne. Chapter 37. The Liedenbrock Museum of Geology. How shall I describe the strange series of passions which in succession shook the breast of Professor Liedenbrock? First stupefaction, then incredulity, lastly a downright burst of rage. Never had I seen the man so put out of countenance and so disturbed. The fatigues of our passage across, the dangers met, had all to be begun over again. We had gone backwards instead of forwards. But my uncle rapidly recovered himself. "Aha! Will fate play tricks upon me? Will the elements lay plots against me? Shall fire, air, and water make a combined attack against me? Well, they shall know what a determined man can do. I will not yield. I will not stir a single foot backwards, and it will be seen whether man or nature is to have the upper hand." Erect upon the rock, angry and threatening, Otto Liedenbrock was a rather grotesque fierce parody upon the fierce Achilles defying the lightning. But I thought it my duty to interpose and attempt to lay some restraint upon this unmeasured fanaticism. "Just listen to me," I said firmly. "Ambition must have a limit somewhere. We cannot perform impossibilities. We are not at all fit for another sea voyage. Who would dream of undertaking a voyage of 500 leagues upon a heap of rotten planks, with a blanket in rags for a sail, a stick for a mast, and fierce winds in our teeth? We cannot steer. We shall be buffeted by the tempests, and we should be fools and madmen to attempt to cross a second time." I was able to develop this series of unanswerable reasons for 10 minutes without interruption. Not that the professor was paying any respectful attention to his nephew's arguments, but because he was deaf to all my eloquence. "To the raft!" he shouted. Such was his only reply. It was no use for me to entreat, supplicate, get angry, or do anything else in the way of opposition. It would only have been opposing a will harder than any granite rock. Hans was finishing the repairs of the raft. One would have thought that this strange being was guessing at my uncle's intentions. With a few more pieces of surtebrand he had refitted our vessel. A sail already hung from the new mast, and the wind was playing in its waving folds. The professor said a few words to the guide, and immediately he put everything on board and arranged every necessary for our departure. The air was clear, and the northwest wind blew steadily. What could I do? Could I stand against the two? It was impossible. If Hans had but taken my side! But no, it was not to be. The Icelander seemed to have renounced all will of his own and made a vow to forget and deny himself. I could get nothing out of a servant so feudalized, as it were, to his master. my only course was to proceed. I was therefore going with as much resignation as I could find to resume my accustomed place on the raft, when my uncle laid his hand upon my shoulder. "We shall not sail until tomorrow," he said. I made a movement intended to express resignation. "I must neglect nothing," he said, "and since my fate has driven me on to this part of the coast, I will not leave it until I have examined it." To understand what followed, it must be borne in mind that, although circumstances hereafter are to be explained, we were not really where the professor supposed we were. In fact, we were not upon the north shore of the sea. "Now let us start upon fresh discoveries," I said. And, leaving Hans to his work, we started off together. The space between the water and the foot of the cliffs was considerable. It took half an hour to bring us to the wall of rock. We trampled under our feet numberless shells of all the forms and sizes which existed in the earliest ages of the world. I also saw immense carapaces, more than 15 feet in diameter. They had been the coverings of those giant glyptodons or armadillos of the Pliocene period, of which the modern tortoise is but a miniature representative. The soil was beside this scattered with stony fragments, boulders rounded by water action, and ridged up in successive lines. I was therefore led to the conclusion that at one time the sea must have covered the ground on which we were treading. On the loose and scattered rocks, now out of reach of the highest tides, the waves had left manifest traces of their power to wear their way in the hardest stone. This might, up to a certain point, explain the existence of an ocean 40 leagues beneath the surface of the globe. But, in my opinion, this liquid mass would be lost by degrees farther and farther within the interior of the earth, and it certainly had its origin in the waters of the ocean overhead, which had made their way hither through some fissure. Yet it must be believed that the fissure is now closed, and that all this cavern or immense reservoir was filled in a very short time. Perhaps even this water, subjected to the fierce action of central heat, had partly been resolved into vapor. This would explain the existence of those clouds suspended above our heads, and the development of that electricity which raised such tempests within the bowels of the earth. This theory of the phenomenon we had witnessed seemed satisfactory to me, for however great and stupendous the phenomena of nature, fixed physical laws will or may always explain them. We were therefore walking upon sedimentary soil, the deposits of the waters of former ages. The professor was carefully examining every little fissure in the rocks. Wherever he saw a hole, he always wanted to know the depth of it. To him, this was important. We had traversed the shores of the Liedenbrock Sea for a mile when we observed a sudden change in the appearance of the soil. It seemed upset, contorted, and convulsed by a violent upheaval of the lower strata. In many places depressions or elevation gave witness to some tremendous power effecting the dislocation of strata. We moved with difficulty across these granite fissures and chasms mingled with silex, crystals of quartz, and alluvial deposits, when a field, nay, more than a field, a vast plain of bleached bones lay spread before us. It seemed like an immense cemetery, where the remains of 20 ages mingled their dust together. Huge mounds of bony fragments rose stage after stage in the distance. They undulated away to the limits of the horizon, and melted in the distance in a faint haze. There, within 3 square miles, were accumulated the materials for a complete history of the animal life of ages, a history scarcely outlined in the 2 recent strata of the inhabited world. But an impatient curiosity impelled our steps. Crackling and rattling, our feet were trampling on the remains of prehistoric animals and interesting fossils, the possession of which is a matter of rivalry and contention between museums of great cities. 1,000 Cuviers could never have reconstructed the organic remains deposited in this magnificent and unparalleled collection. I stood amazed. My uncle had uplifted his long arms to the vault which was our sky, his mouth gaping wide, his eyes flashing behind his shining spectacles, his head balancing with an up-and-down motion, his whole attitude denoted unlimited astonishment. Here he stood facing an immense collection of scattered Leptotheria, Mericotheria, Lophiodia, Amplotheria, Megatheria, Mastodons, Proterpithecae, Pterodactyls, and all sorts of extinct monsters here assembled together for his special satisfaction. Fancy an enthusiastic bibliomaniac suddenly brought into the midst of the famous Alexandrian library, burnt by Omar and restored by a miracle from its ashes. Just such a crazed enthusiast was my uncle, Professor Liedenbrock. But more was to come when, with a rush through the clouds of bone dust, he laid his hand upon a bare skull, and cried with a voice trembling with excitement, "Axel! Axel! A human head!" "A human skull?" I cried, no less astonished. "Yes, nephew. Aha! Monsieur Milne Edwards! Aha! Monsieur de Quatrefages! How I wish you were standing here at the side of Otto Liedenbrock." End of chapter 37. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information on how to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recorded by Lena Taylor of the I Read Comics podcast. Chapter 38. The Professor in His Chair Again. To understand this apostrophe of my uncle's, made to absent French savants, it will be necessary to allude to an event of high importance in a paleontological point of view, which had occurred a little while before our departure. On the 28th of March, 1863, some excavators working under the direction of Monsieur Boucher de Perth in the stone quarries of Moulin-Quignon, near Abbeville, in the department of Somme, found a human jawbone 14 feet beneath the surface. It was the first fossil of this nature that had ever been brought to light. Not far distant were found stone hatchets and flint arrowheads stained and encased by lapse of time with a uniform coat of rust. The noise of this discovery was very great, not in France alone, but in England and in Germany. Several savants of the French Institute, amongst them Messieurs Milne Edwards and de Quatrefages, saw at once the importance of this discovery, proved to demonstration the genuineness of the bone in question, and became the most ardent defendants in what the English called this trial of a jawbone. To geologists of the United Kingdom, who believed in the certainty of the fact, Messieurs Falconer, Busk, Carpenter, and others, scientific Germans were soon joined, and amongst them the forwardest, the most fiery, and the most enthusiastic was my uncle Liedenbrock. Therefore, the genuineness of a fossil human relic of the Quaternary period seemed to be incontestably proved and admitted. It is true that this theory met with a most obstinate opponent in Monsieur Elie de Beaumont. This high authority maintained that the soil of Moulin-Quignon was not diluvial at all, but was of a much more recent formation, and, agreeing in that with Cuvier, he refused to admit that the human species could be contemporary with the animals of the Quaternary period. My uncle Liedenbrock, along with the great body of the geologists, had maintained his ground, disputed, and argued, until Monsieur Elie de Beaumont stood almost alone in his opinion. We knew all these details, but we were not aware that since our departure the question had advanced to farther stages. Other similar maxillaries, though belonging to individuals of various types and different nations, were found in the loose gray soil of certain grottos in France, Switzerland, and Belgium, as well as weapons, tools, earthen utensils, bones of children and adults. The existence, therefore, of man in the Quaternary period seemed to become daily more certain. Nor was this all. Fresh discoveries of remains in the Pliocene formation had emboldened other geologists to refer back the human species to a higher antiquity still. It is true that these remains were not human bones, but objects bearing the traces of his handiwork, such as fossil leg bones of animals, sculptured and carved evidently by the hand of man. Thus, at one bound, the record of existence of man receded far back into the history of the ages past, He was a predecessor of the mastodon. He was a contemporary of the southern elephant. He lived 100,000 years ago, when, according to geologists, the Pliocene formation was in progress. Such, then, was the state of paleontological science, and what we knew of it was sufficient to explain our behavior in the presence of this stupendous Golgotha. Anyone may now understand the frenzied excitement of my uncle when, 20 yards farther on, he found himself face to face with a primitive man. It was a perfectly recognizable human body. Had some particular soil, like that of the Cemetery Saint-Michel at Bordeaux, preserved it thus for so many ages? It might be so. But this dried corpse, with its parchment-like skin drawn tightly over the bony frame, the limbs still preserving their shape, sound teeth, abundant hair, and finger and toenails of frightful length, this desiccated mummy startled us by appearing just as it had lived countless ages ago. I stood mute before this apparition of remote antiquity. My uncle, usually so garrulous, was struck dumb likewise. We raised the body. We stood it up against a rock. It seemed to stare at us out of its empty orbits. We sounded with our knuckles his hollow frame. After some moments' silence, the professor was himself again. Otto Liedenbrock, yielding to his nature, forgot all the circumstances of our eventful journey, forgot where we were standing, forgot the vaulted cavern which contained us. No doubt he was in mind back again in his Johannium, holding forth to his pupils, for he assumed his learned air, and, addressing himself to an imaginary audience, he proceeded thus. "Gentlemen, I have the honor to introduce to you a man of the quaternary or post-tertiary system. Eminent geologists have denied his existence. Others no less eminent have affirmed it. The St. Thomases of paleontology, if they were here, might now touch him with their fingers, and would be obliged to acknowledge their error. I am quite aware that science has to be on its guard with discoveries of this kind. I know what capital enterprising individuals like Barnum have made out of fossil men. I have heard the tale of the knee pan of Ajax, the pretended body of Orestes claimed to have been found by the Spartans, and of the body of Asterius, 10 cubits long, of which Pausanias speaks. I have read the reports of the skeleton of Trapani, found in the 14th century, and which was at the time identified as that of Polyphemus, and the history of the giant unearthed in the 16th century near Palermo. You know, as well as I do, gentlemen, the analysis made at Lucerne in 1577 of those huge bones, which the celebrated Dr. Felix Plater affirmed to be those of a giant 19 feet high. I have gone through the treatises of Cassanion, and all those memoirs, pamphlets, answers, and rejoinders published respecting the skeleton of Teutobochus, the invader of Gaul, dug out of a sand-pit in the Dauphine in 1613. In the 18th century I would have stood up for Scheuser's pre-Adamite man against Peter Campet. I have perused a writing, entitled Gigant— Here my uncle's unfortunate infirmity met him, that of being unable in public to pronounce hard words. The pamphlet entitled Gigant— He could get no further. Gigantio— It was not to be done. The unlucky word would not come out. At the Johannium there would have been a laugh. Giganto-osteology, at last the professor burst out between two words which I shall not record here. Then, rushing on with renewed vigor and great animation. Yes, gentlemen, I know all these things and more. I know that Cuvier and Blumenbach have recognized in these bones nothing more remarkable than the bones of the mammoth and other mammals of the post-tertiary period. But in the presence of this specimen, to doubt would be to insult science. There stands the body. You may see it, touch it. It is not a mere skeleton. It is an entire body, preserved for a purely anthropological end and purpose. I was good enough not to contradict this startling assertion. If I could only wash it in a solution of sulfuric acid, pursued my uncle, I should be able to clear it from all the earthly particles and the shells which are encrusted about it. But I do not possess that valuable solvent. Yet, such as it is, the body shall tell us its own wonderful story. Here the professor laid hold of the fossil skeleton and handled it with the skill of a dexterous showman. "You see," he said, "that it is not 6 feet long, and that we are still separated by a long interval from the pretended race of giants. As to the family to which it belongs, it is evidently Caucasian. It is the white race, our own. The skull of this fossil is a regular oval, or rather, ovoid. It exhibits no prominent cheekbones, no projecting jaws. It presents no appearance of that prognathism which diminishes the facial angle. Measure that angle. It is nearly 90 degrees. But I will go further in my deductions, and I will affirm that this specimen of the human family is of the Japhetic race, which has since spread from the Indies to the Atlantic. Don't smile, gentlemen." Nobody was smiling, but the learned professor was frequently disturbed by the broad smiles provoked by his learned eccentricities. "Yes," he pursued with animation, "this is a fossil man, the contemporary of the mastodons whose remains fill this amphitheatre. But if you ask me how he came here, how those strata on which he lay slipped down into this enormous hollow in the globe, I confess I cannot answer that question. No doubt, in this post-tertiary period, considerable commotions were still disturbing the crust of the earth. The long-continued cooling of the globe produced chasms, fissures, clefts, and faults, into which, very probably, portions of the upper earth may have fallen. I make no rash assertions. But there is the man, surrounded by his own works, by hatchets, by flint arrowheads, which are the characteristics of the Stone Age. And, unless he came here like myself, as a tourist on a visit, and as a pioneer of science, I can entertain no doubt of the authenticity of his remote origin." The professor ceased to speak, and the audience broke out into loud and unanimous applause. For of course my uncle was right, and wiser men than his nephew would have had some trouble to refute his statements. Another remarkable thing: the fossil body was not the only one in this immense catacomb. We came upon other bodies at every step amongst this mortal dust, and my uncle might select the most curious of these specimens to demolish the incredulity of skeptics. In fact, it was a wonderful spectacle, that of these generations of men and animals commingled in a common cemetery. Then one very serious question arose presently, which we scarcely dared to suggest. Had all those creatures slided through a great fissure in the crust of the earth, down to the shores of the Liedenbrock Sea, when they were dead and turning to dust? Or had they lived and grown and died here in this subterranean world under a false sky, just like inhabitants of the upper earth? Until the present time we had seen alive only marine monsters and fishes. Might not some living man, some native of the abyss, be yet a wanderer below on this desert strand? End of chapter 38.